So good evening, everyone. For those of you who this is the first time, this series, welcome. Every lecture that we've had so far is a standalone as part of a much larger series that we're running on mindfulness, meaningfulness through mindfulness. And so every week we've had different presenters present from a different aspect of life improvement and general wellness in order to help us live better lives. However, it's not just about knowing, it's also about finding ways to implement. And so tonight is actually possibly the feature of the entire series. As I mentioned earlier, we're very lucky tonight to have my mother-in-law, Dr. Debbie Herbst, speak tonight. That's not how she got the gig. She got the gig because she's actually one of the leading specialists, I would say, at least on this part of Melbourne, if not all of Melbourne, if not in Australia, on creating real changes in your life, particularly around food and lifestyle changes, to see immediate positive change in your life. For those of you who are recognizing her and wondering, where do I know that face? Yes, she's the doctor from that sugar movie, that sugar film. So there we are, celebrity in the house. And but before we can get to that, tonight is about exploring both mindfulness as well as the changes that we can make within our day-to-day life, particularly through food, but also to do with the environment around us, the things that we're integrating with, the things that we're engaging with. At Spiritgrow, we advocate for five key areas of change in life. There are five very simple things to change in life, because there is no minimum requirement, there is no maximum goal. It's just about being conscious of these five things in life, of which I'm only going to speak of two, because my mother-in-law will speak about not only the other three, but she'll talk about a lot more and bring us to a point of so much greater awareness. In life, and when I say life, I mean day-to-day, engaging with your children, with your spouse, with your aging parent, whatever it is that you deal with, your colleagues at work, etc., you will find that you have better days and you have worse days. A worse day is where everyone's annoying you, or you might be annoying everyone else. And a better day is a day in which everyone seems to be just operating the way you would like them to. And often we think it's because of the other people around us, or the drivers around us, or the weather around us. And while it may have to do with them, there are a number of things that are going on inside us that are changing and impacting the way we are responding to the whole world around us. And so I'm going to run through all five so that you can say, well, at least I heard what the big five were. They are, the first thing to check is, have you eaten? Or are you a little hyperglycemic? Or have you eaten the wrong foods and as a result you've gone up and you've gone down? Or are you eating the sort of foods that keep you permanently crabby? So before we even wonder if the person around us is annoying us, what have we done for our own self through food? I'm not going to talk further about that because that's not my field. It's just my place to ask the question. Number two is, have you slept? And if you have slept well? Or are you coming off 5 days of less than 3 hours a night? Or have you come off 20 years of less than 3 hours a night because it keeps being broken by children, by insomnia, by anxiety, whatever it is? In which case, are you finding that it's hard to focus, hard to concentrate, and hard to be patient with people? It may have nothing to do with anything except what's going on inside. Number three is the exercise. There are so many reasons to exercise, but one of the most interesting studies on exercise, which was presented here a number of years back by Professor Mark Cohen, is that exercise for the oxygen alone makes exercise worthwhile. That often we are operating with not enough oxygen in the blood, not enough oxygen coming to the brain. We're feeling lethargic, feeling tired, feeling grumpy. And as I like to say, no one ever says, I regret going for a walk because now I feel good. But you do say, I don't want to go for a walk because I feel lousy, I feel down. So these are the big three of five, which can make a terribly positive change in our life if we just do something, if we just snack, if we just take a cat nap, or if we just go for a 20-minute walk and we get our heart rate up, so much change can go on right then and there. But there are two things that I want to talk a bit about tonight because they underpin so many things in our life. And they are mindfulness and meditation. And the other one is a spirituality, a personal spirituality. Why is mindfulness so important? Well, first, the studies. The studies show that practicing mindfulness meditation of between 5 and 10 minutes a day, so I'm not even talking about half an hour, I'm not talking about crossing your legs, I'm not talking about anything, I'm just talking about sitting in the driver's seat of your car, turning off the keys, turning off the ignition. If you don't feel self-conscious that people are going to walk past and see a corpse sitting in the driver's seat, and you just close your eyes and quite simply listen to your breath. Doesn't matter what noise is going on around you, doesn't matter what you're thinking about, just listen to your breath and allow the thoughts and the sounds to pass you by. And I'm going to do an exercise with you to help you see how simple this is. Why is that so important? Because this practice of mindfulness allows for two things to take place. Number one, in that state, we can move into a point of relaxation and inner awareness of how we feel. Is there tension? Is the acid in our stomach rising? Have I got a ruminating thought that's haunting me? What is going on? And is it really that bad, or is it just that my mind has turned it into something tragic? In this moment, am I feeling threatened? And if the answer is no, continue breathing. Slow breaths, deep breaths, slowly, slowly, and within 7 minutes, you will have, if you've got high adrenaline, you'll have brought that down. And within 3 minutes, you'll have already begun to relax. So just through that. And the metaphor that we always use, it's like a plumber cleaning out the pipes. You don't have to change the pipes. You just need to clean them out. And when they're cleaned, there's no blockage. And so what the mindfulness studies have shown is that through the practice of mindfulness meditation, not only do we build our awareness of what's going on to be able to respond, but in the actual exercise itself, we release tension and we actually get the body to relax. It doesn't get stored away. It's not a case of, oh, I've got all this pent-up energy because I keep repressing and suppressing it. It's not that. It's actually dissolved through the meditation. So the place of mindfulness meditation is so important just for the balance of day-to-day life, but also to build an awareness of, ooh, I'm hungry, that's why I'm behaving like this. Ooh, I'm tired, that's why. I'm feeling the fatigue, now I know. I'm feeling the empty stomach, now I know. Or I haven't really moved much, now I know. It's building that awareness without having to think, but just knowing what's going on inside our own body. Because most people in the Western society today are not aware what they are doing or when they are doing it. Even when you think you know what you're doing, you're still thinking about 15 other things and you're not actually thinking about what it is that you're doing. So we're actually not very present or aware in most of the things that we do. And by practicing this, it doesn't just mean, oh, well, you're getting 10 minutes of mindfulness a day. It actually changes the brain so that you become more aware and mindful moment to moment to moment, every moment of your day. So it's not just about the 10 minutes, but it's what it creates in the rest of the day. Of course, if you can get up to half an hour a day or 2 times 20 minutes, you're going to be like Superman. You'll be like, you become the next Dalai Lama. I don't know what could happen to you, but you'll be up there. But then there is something deeper than that, deeper content-wise, and that's the spirituality of life. And that is the why should I? Why should I exercise? Why should I eat well? Why should I sleep? Why should I meditate? I don't want to. Why? Because I don't want to. So it's very important that we have our why. Why do you get up in the morning? Is it purely because you can't sleep anymore? Or is there a purpose in why you're getting up? And the purpose is not a job. The job is part of the is also just there to service the purpose. Is it family? Is it pleasure? What is your why for why you get up in the morning? What is the motivation to want to do something? So that's a personal spirituality. It's not so much a religious spirituality. It's a personal value. And it's very important to have that. And I can't write that for you. All I can ask you is to become aware, do you have a why or do you not have a why? Because if you have the why, then you've got a motivation. If you don't have the why, it's going to be very hard to motivate yourself. But enter some of the most interesting wisdom that comes out of Kabbalistic teaching. There are two sides to the self. If you would actually divide a person, you would find that the person is not one thing. The person is many things. We are made up of many parts, and we have many layers to ourselves. We've got we are not just like an onion, because even when you get to our very core, there are more layers to be peeled. And when you think about what a person is, we're not our feelings, we're not our thoughts, we're not our actions, we're not our body, and yet we're all of those, and we're not even the sum of all those things. We are more than the sum of all our things, because we all know if you build a Frankenstein, it won't live. It's not about just collecting these organs and trying to get it to live. There's something more. We are a soul. We are a life. And what that means is that we are complex. There is the higher order self and the lower order self. In Hebrew, you'll find things like the Nefesh Bahamit and the Nefesh Elokit, loosely translated as the altruistic godly soul, or the hedonistic animal soul. These are not opposites, they are just different focused parts of ourself. So our soul is a complex being. And what the Nefesh Bahamit, what this lower order self is about self-preservation followed by pleasure. Pleasure generally is interpreted as a good thing. If you are experiencing pleasure, you're alive. That's a good thing. The fact that the pleasure is a result of something that might kill you doesn't really get factored into when you're having pleasurable experiences. You don't really think, well, that's not really healthy. No, there's a part of you that's saying, this is good. You're alive. You're enjoying life. There is no other purpose for living. And if you're not having pleasure, you're at least seeking life. So if someone attacks you, you defend yourself or you fight back. If you're hungry, you go and eat. If you're thirsty, you go and drink. Whatever it is that you want, the lower order self drives you to doing it, even if it comes at a cost to someone else. The higher order self, the Nefesh Elokit, is the part of us that makes us altruistic. It's the part of us that makes us aware and focus on things that aren't going to benefit us. So you get people that go and help out in Africa. It's a silly thing to do, because you're going to get malaria, you're going to get attacked by some criminal. Why would you do such a thing? It's a silly thing to do, and yet people do it, because it's not about whether it's silly or not. It's about that they want, for no other reason except to give, to go out there and give. There's nothing in it for them. There's no media story about every volunteer. There's no fanfare for every person that does good. One in every 100,000 gets an article about, oh, they're doing wonderful work in Rwanda. They're doing wonderful work over here or there. But the average Joe Blow, who's just out to make a difference, is doing it purely for altruistic reasons. And that will come at a cost to them. They'll have to pay to fly over. It'll cost them in their health. It will cost them in their sleep. It will cost them in stress and what they're confronted with. And the lower order self is like, don't do that. You could have gone to Vegas with that money. You could have doubled or nothing. You're definitely not making the money when you go to Africa or Southeast Asia, wherever you're going. And yet the higher order self says, yeah, but I live for something greater than myself. It's not about my personal benefit. It's what I need to be, what I need to do. So we've got these two sides of us. Further, what it teaches in Kabbalah is that the person has one goal subtly in the background to master in life. And that is to live a life of where the mind has full control over the decision-making process of the heart. And what that means is that we should be using an intellectual process to decide what we're doing in life rather than an emotional process. So we don't do things because we want them. We should be doing things because we know them to be correct. We know that that's where what we should be doing. It's where we can say, I really, really want, but the mind says, it's not good. Or I really, really don't want, and the mind says, you really should. And the mind, when it takes control of the body, can get the person to do incredible things. And that happens through our consciousness and through our awareness of any situation. Having a legal system helps us. The law helps me know what is right and what is wrong. The fact that I want makes no difference. The mind will say, don't break the law, or do this, don't do that. Even though you want to, or even though you don't want to, the Meach Shalat HaLev, the mind rules over the heart to be able to get a person to do the things they don't want to do, and to not do the things that they really want to do when they're not good. So now let's work backwards. In every single moment of our day, we should be living with an awareness, with a mindfulness. And how do we do that? Through practicing mindfulness for 5 to 10 minutes a day. And through that practice, it will become just the way we live. What we do with that awareness is we employ our spirituality, we employ our value system to make decisions. Tonight, we're going to hear a lot of important information. Tonight, we're going to hear practical steps and wisdom. And what we need to do is walk out of this and become aware of when we rebel against the knowledge, that we say, I can rise above this. Because very often we say, I can't. I really can't. I don't have the strength. So I can't. I don't have the strength. Why not? Have I not slept? Have I not eaten properly? Have I not exercised? What is the reason? So before we even tackle the problem, let's become aware of how we're feeling. Employ the Meir Shalat Alalev. Employ the mind over the heart and say, I live for something greater and therefore I will push myself that much further. And that is how the mindfulness process, as taught within the spiritual teachings of Jewish mysticism, will help us live a life in accordance with the main part of tonight's presentation. So I'd like to invite Dr. Debbie Herbst to give us the knowledge for which we will become mindful. And hopefully by the end of the evening, not only will you be meditating, but you'll also be practicing. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks, Menachem. I sort of almost feel like I can probably just tell you a few quick lines and talk briefly about what healthy living is and how we do it, and then we can all go home because Menachem's now inspired us that it's quite simple, really, isn't it? It's just about having the knowledge and then putting it into practice. And if we employ the strategies of mindfulness and believing that we're here for a higher purpose, and that higher purpose is about having meaning in our lives and living for a higher spiritual focus, then what couldn't be wrong? What could be hard about it? And I speak once a year, some of you are aware that we have in Melbourne, as part in the Chabad community, a seminary for post-high school girls who come mainly from overseas to study here for a year, but also some Australian girls. And I speak to them once a year about healthy eating. It's interesting that the focus has shifted. A number of years ago, the headmaster wanted me to speak very much about eating disorders. And now the focus is shifted away a little bit from that, although not saying that that's not important as well. And so when I speak to the girls, I say, you know, it's almost like if you're religious and you live by the Torah, and as Menachem's saying, we recognise we've got an animal soul and a godly soul, and our life is to elevate everything in the world to something higher and spiritual, then surely it's simple to just harness our physical beings and our physical bodies and only do good things to it and with it, right? It's easy. I guess the medical way of asking that same question is that when doctors or health professionals give us messages about what healthy living looks like and sounds like and feels like, it should just be, you know, fact sheet and you just go home and you do it. But we know there's a lot more to it. It's all about motivation, contemplation. But I think I would like this evening, if we go home with the take-home message of what Menachem was talking about really about why we're here, what we're here for, not just here tonight, but in the bigger picture, more existential question about why we're here and trying to enhance our lives. So as you know, the topic is training mindful taste buds. So it's quite an interesting sort of play on things, I guess. But really what we talk, you know, I will talk somewhat about diet and food, but really looking at things in a larger picture, in a little bit more holistic sense. So when we think about, you know, healthy living, everybody, you know, probably has some different ideas about what that means. And it means different things clearly to different people. Anyone here have anything else besides what I've written up there? What does healthy living mean? No? Okay. So obviously, you know, for some people, healthy living, I mean, the first thing they think about all healthy living means what you eat. Because if you eat well, and very much concept of food being our medicine, that food is the fuel for our bodies and ultimately nourish, and that's how, you know, we nourish our soul as well, and vice versa. that surely if we're going to be healthy, what we're putting in, if you like the fuel source of our beings, needs to be healthy. Now, clearly there's differences of opinion what that might mean, and we'll talk about some of that tonight. For some people, when we say healthy living, they might have the image in their head of, you know, going to the gym 5 days a week, or going for a jog on the weekend, or trying getting outside, being active with the kids, being active to some people. And they might think, well, I can get away with, you know, I don't have to worry too much about the fuel that I'm putting in because I'm being active. And we know that is important. Healthy living, is that all about long life? Is that all about being on this planet, you know, for a long time? We know now average life expectancy, I don't remember exactly the figure, 88.2 years or 86 point, whatever it is, that if someone, a child is born today, can expect to live, well, over 80 years, which has obviously increased in the last few decades. Is that what it means to be healthy, just to be here for a long time? I don't think many people would be so excited, just the thought of being physically present without having some of the other factors. So in some of the Eastern models, and in some of the, as opposed to the strict Western idea of what healthy living, it's about optimal health. Now, part of that is absence of disease, if we don't have any disease states. But again, that's pretty, you know, it can be quite subjective. What does absence of disease mean? Does it mean if I just haven't had a cold for the last 6 months, or does it mean I don't have diabetes, or I don't have asthma, or I don't have any of the chronic? What does absence of disease mean? But I think most people, well, healthy living means you can get on and do what you want to do, whatever that might be, as Menachem said, when you wake up in the morning, what is it that you're here for? To some people, healthy living means that your environment, your surroundings are clean, are free from pollution, maybe free from noise pollution, free from mind pollution, free from stress. So environment, there's a lot of different aspects about what a clean environment, and certainly that, you know, is very important as well. And the last question that I've written there is, are we living longer today than our parents and our grandparents? And the short answer is no. And some of you may have heard and be aware that over the last few years, actually, when I said if a child born today will actually have a shorter life expectancy than a child born in the last generation, well, you know, 15, 20 years ago, which is actually quite very sobering and something that, you know, clearly we need to be thinking about. So the idea of living longer, we've all said, well, you know, most people aren't happy just with being physically present for longer, but in fact, that's not even true anymore, and we'll see why. So we all think, you know, we've in this very highly techno society, and we've got rid of a lot of the sort of diseases and disease states that people had to combat previously, but I think we've replaced them. So then that just little pie chart about some of those different factors. I saw this somewhere, that healthy living is about being in good shape. And again, it touches on some of those things we spoke about before that I mentioned. So when we talk about our surroundings, so that, as I said before, that might be living in Caulfield as opposed to living in Brunswick, or living in Caulfield as opposed to living in Eltham. Living in Caulfield as opposed to living in high density living, or living in Caulfield as opposed to living in Africa. So it's about our macro environment where we live, and these are key determinants definitely in life expectancy and opportunities, and even even if some of the research, if you look at certain risk factors for disease, very different across different suburbs, even within Melbourne. That's also got to do with socioeconomics, education opportunities, but even within our city, it can affect you. So where you live is important, and it's not just as if you live rural or city, but even within a city that can matter. And then the micro environment, who do you live with? What support structures? What community do you live in? Who's at home with you? Do you have children? Do you have parents? And relationships are key as well. Health, as we said before, you know, there's all different ways. How do we measure health? And there's, you know, epidemiologists and people who do this, obviously, for a living. We've spoken a little bit about what does healthy living mean? Again, how long you live, absence of heart disease, absence of chronic disease, absence of, you know, all sorts of things. Is that what healthy is? So epidemiologists and scientists like to measure these things. So part of our health can have to do with our past. So what might be some lifestyle stuff we've done in the past, and some other issues. attitudes. Now, Menachem's spoken a lot, you know, really about attitudes, and we'll touch along a little bit, and you see I have the word spirituality up there. We didn't do prepare this together, by the way, so hopefully one of the themes is that a lot of what we're saying really crosses over. So Menachem spoke obviously about mindfulness and leading to sort of a calmer state, and a lot of people that might bring in happiness, satisfaction, which can be very helpful in achieving and maintaining healthy life. And community, vitally important. Now, parents are genetic factors. Every day when I speak to people about their risk factors for various diseases, we can't change our genes yet. So it is what it is. Like, sometimes when people tell me, oh, it's not fair. It's not fair. Then I say, well, it's not fair. I'm not 6 foot tall. I'm not blonde. I don't have blue eyes. I'm very fair-skinned. It's not fair that when I go outside, I burn really quickly. But I know that for me, it means I can't spend a lot of time outside in sun, even with sunscreen on, because that's who I am. It's got to do with my parents, my genetics. And it's not, you can look at it in the bigger picture, it's not fair, or you can say, well, that's who I am. That like some of those things that make me unique, and everybody's got their own unique genetic makeup. So working with it rather than against it. And, yeah, last but not least, and one of the key things, and we'll talk about it in a minute, is really about eating. So the last in the acronym of SHAPE, of being in good shape, is about what we eat. And it's about making, as it says, the informed choices. So I will touch on it because it's obviously one of my pet topics, is about that over the last 40 years there's been very much energy in versus energy out. And it's all really simple. We've all heard it all before. If you just eat less and you move more, you'll stay healthy weight. And being a healthy weight is all, as I said, those epidemiologists will tell you that if you stay a healthy weight, you're at much lower risk of developing heart disease, diabetes, all sorts of other things. You'll live longer by default. Therefore, you'll be happier, because that's what it's about, isn't it? Living longer, happier. So being in this healthy weight range that they've defined is really simple, isn't it? It's just don't eat so much and move more, and that's all there is to it. So a lot of us in the field have recognised and are now starting to obviously challenge that. Now, we can go into the history of it, but that's taken from physics models. So the physics model, whether you boil up a 100 mils or a litre of water and how much heat does it take and how quick. Now, that's all very nice when you're boiling a pot of water on the stove, how much heat do you need? But it does, we're living, multifaceted, living organisms, living beings made up of many different things. As I've said, it's all got to do with your surroundings, where you come from, where you live, who your parents were, what happened to you in your past. There's another emerging field is about what happened to your mother when she was in her mother's womb, so your grandmother, what happened? Epigenetics, exactly. It's not just the genes, but what was going on in her environment has a big part in who you are, not in who you are in terms of your personality, but a lot of lifestyle, health issues are determined generations back. And again, it's separate from just the genetic factors. So this idea of epigenetics. So there's a lot of new work and research being done. Just another little thing I'll throw out there. Also, one of the other big emerging fields is in about gut flora, the gut microbiota. You've probably heard about that, and people hear about, taking probiotics, and it's really important. So there's some research being done, because we started to talk about being a healthy weight, that the difference between two different people who might seemingly have the same energy in, same energy out, so they'll measure, do the calorie thing and how many calories you're eating per day and how much you're expending, but be totally different weight. And, of course, as I'm saying, it's all got to do with all these other influences that are going on. But now one new theory is that it's got large to do with your gut microbiota, so the balance between the good and the bad bacteria in your gut and your particular balance, which again has been influenced by all these various things. And there's some work being done in multiple areas, not just in weight loss, in doing fecal transplants, which I know sounds, people usually get a bit freaked out about that idea, but I'm just putting it out there. So there's a lot of new research being done, and it's what we have to, I guess, move away from is not all about energy in, energy out. And if it would be, and it's actually quite offensive really to me that people still talk about that so much, because by implication that is saying that we're all you know, the 30-35% of the population who are overweight or obese or even more, the numbers keep going up every year, and children are just either lazy, stupid, you know, can't follow instructions, didn't listen properly. That's really what it's saying. It's saying, well, if it's as simple as energy in and energy out, then you're either not listening or you're too stupid or you're too lazy, you're just not following it. So it's actually offensive to me to keep on pushing that line. We've got to start looking at the bigger picture and saying, you know, really what is going on and how can we affect change. And, yeah. So down the bottom I said, really it's about informed choice and making the right choices and the right decisions, which isn't exactly the same for any two people, really. I mean, the principles might be similar, but not exactly the same. So I've put down there a little line down the bottom that insulin is a central figure, is a central player in all of this. And I'm not going to go too much about the role of insulin in disease. I was going to say in health. It's more in disease. Other than to say that it is a really key player, just sort of hold that thought that insulin, now we all know, people know very simply, insulin is very involved in how we metabolize carbohydrates, sugars. So we know that people who are type 1 diabetics don't have enough insulin. Their body just didn't make enough, so therefore they need to inject themselves. People type 2 diabetes is actually the opposite, where their body initially starts to make too much insulin, overproduce it, because their body for some reason isn't getting the message properly. When they eat carbohydrate foods, things aren't quite working and they actually make excess insulin. It's called and they develop insulin resistance and ultimately diabetes. Now, some people like to, keep it, that's all, just don't think about insulin other than in diabetes. It doesn't really matter. But we know that insulin is a key player in being significantly involved in the inflammatory process. And inflammation, as we'll see in a minute, is key to a lot of disease and the opposite of health. So it's interesting to think about that in the past, so up until, you know, the modern era, it was quite simple, really. What killed most people was infectious disease. You know, if you want to go back, you know, you'll say obviously natural disasters, but most people probably died of one infection or another in the, you know, pre-sanitary conditions, pre-antibiotics, clearly, pre-sort of knowledge. And so that it was quite simple that if you got rid of the infections, if you could treat that, then people would live longer. And so, yeah, through various public health strategies, whether that be, you know, just cleaner, you know, good sanitation, good sewerage collection systems, being aware of sort of hygiene and cleanliness, and then, like I said, through to appropriate antibiotics, immunisations. Yeah, so it seemed quite simple. So sort of in the, you know, late end of World War II is when antibiotics started to be used widely. And everyone thought, oh, it's going to be really easy, right? People aren't going to get sick anymore because we're going to be able to cure all disease, and it was very relatively simple. Today, we are dealing with a lot more than that, and we're dealing with what we call this epidemic of chronic disease. So we spoke about, you know, what does it mean to be healthy, and the opposite of is this concept of chronic disease. So we all know, people think of, you know, asthma, diabetes, as I said, arthritis, heart disease, I'll throw thyroid disease in there because that's another big one. So a whole range of autoimmune diseases, and I don't have the slides tonight, but these diseases are all on the rise, in particular autoimmune disease. And so, for example, the incidence of people having issues with their thyroid, so autoimmune thyroiditis, like the incidence is, you know, in the last 20 years, just sort of goes through the roof. And again, if we want to go back to that overly simplistic, offensive idea, it's all because people are just fat and lazy and not doing what the doctors are telling them. But clearly there's got to be more to the picture. So today we're dealing with, well, is it one, you know, it'd be nice if it was just, yes, those bad, evil germs, we just get rid of the germs and we'll all be healthy again. We're now dealing with a whole lot more. We've really sort of complicated it. Yeah, as I said, so down the bottom, people would like to keep it simple, but unfortunately the model doesn't work anymore. So, hang on. There we go. So as it says down the bottom, we've gone the wrong way. We're doing something wrong, clearly, because, as I said, life expectancy is going down. Children born today are going to live, unless we change something dramatically, are going to live less. And we've got this literal epidemic of, you know, modern disease, modern chronic disease. So you know, we talk about what are the determinants of inflammation. I mentioned before insulin, which is key, and that's all got to do with certain food groups. But there's a whole hierarchy of things that are at play. Like I said, but it's no longer sort of as simplistic as it used to be. It's a lot more complicated. So they talk about these things called anthropogens. And what are they? As it says, so it's the environments and the lifestyles that are leading to these diseases. So, yeah, it's a bit depressing, really, that we've got ourselves into this mess, but how are we going to get out of it? Obviously, first is key is education, is understanding it. How did we get in there? Where have we gone wrong? How do we turn it around? Because we can turn it around, and hopefully we will. So, interestingly, I came across this acronym, the nasty malodors. And so really what this is, Menachem mentioned before, he was going to speak about five key determinants, and he spoke about, you know, the three, the sleep, eat, nutrition and exercise, but there's really a whole lot more, and it's sort of a hierarchy. Nutrition, N for nutrition, is at top because that is the most important. That is probably the single most important determinant in what contributes to disease, and what we can also, as I said, mentioned before, food can be medicine, can actually prevent or stave off a lot of illness. And then we'll walk down the list. So, you know, in the next few minutes, that's what we're going to go do, sort of just go through some of these. So from top to bottom, but they're all important. And I think the other thing to sort of think about is that they're on some level obviously all interconnected and related. So, yeah, that's just a little graphic way of putting some of those things. And so my little, you know, the one at the top where the kids are sort of being very mindful, practicing mindfulness, and then overlaid with, you know, the Facebook heart. So that touches on relationships, you know, real relationships, not so real relationships, you know, there's stress, the world all going around, all these sort of things that we'll touch on, you know, homelessness over here, and very importantly, sleep, as Menachem mentioned as well. So in nutrition, so this could be an entire talk in itself, but you know, again, as Menachem mentioned, I was a doctor involved in that sugar film, and it's something that I do play sort of quite a key role. Some of you might, every week actually I get new patients because they come across me. I'm on a group called Low Carb Down Under, which is a group of doctors and health professionals that are trying to change things a little bit, and it's hard going. But when I was in the sugar film, was made in 2013, and when I was in the sugar film, that's probably some of you have seen, these messages were very, you know, viewed as alternate, and people sort of looked at you, you know, what planet are you from, and don't you know, just eat less and move more, it's quite simple. But so in the few years since then, really, you know, we have seen demonstrable change, and one of my other key passions is actually working with school groups and speaking to kids, because they're obviously, the teenagers are really, you know, they really get hyped up and very involved in it. So I've spoken to various, mainly teenage groups about, you know, what can they do to change things, recognising the world that they find themselves in, and how can we sort of turn things around a little bit. So in the field of nutrition, I mean, these are not all my ideas, but this is taken from sort of some evidence. So what do we know, what can we say has been associated, again, you know, these are from epidemiological studies, some of this information, that, you know, what can we do? What can possibly decrease the risk of developing some of these chronic diseases? So one of the key things, and you've probably all heard about the, you know, two fruits, five veggies, and a couple of weeks ago now they're saying it's 10 veggies. Did you all hear that? Yeah. So it used to be seven a day, so two serves of fruit, five different vegetables. Now some studies out of the UK saying, no, five's not enough, it needs to be 10. Anyway, the idea is, my little thing down here, trying to get a variety, and that some people, there's all different ways of giving over the same message. So some people say, try and choose a fruit and vegetable, different colour every day. So an orange, a green, a red, a yellow. And if you think about it, if you do that, you're going to be getting a nice variety of you know, fresh produce. So that's one of the things. Definitely eating less processed foods is a significant thing in trying to stave off chronic disease. So we'll talk a little bit about that. The World Health Organization has come out, and that's, again, the sugar film. We're not some wacko fringe alternate group. The World Health Organization has come out a couple of years ago with the guidelines that people should eat no more than 6 to 9 teaspoons of sugar per day. Now that you'll see very quick that's in all the foods that you eat. So there's sugar. Now we talk about it can be quite difficult. People say, well, you know, how much sugar is. I remember after the sugar film, and I don't know if any of you've watched it, a lot of people when they watch it, they go home and they furiously empty out their pantry and start reading all the labels, you know, how much sugar's in this. And my mother, I remember, so she went and she says, oh, we don't need any sugar. I don't put sugar in tea. Oh, we don't need sugar. And then she pulls out the Vegemite jar. She goes, is there any sugar in this? And, you know, it was sugar. And then she started, you know, reading all the labels and quickly realised there's in just about every single processed food, whether you know about it or not. I mean, things like tomato sauce, the barbecue sauce, like frightening amount. I think it's like 58 teaspoons of sugar in a standard bottle of. Now, no one ever eats the whole thing of barbecue sauce all at once, but that means in a standard serving, you could be easily eating the equivalent of 2 to 3 teaspoons of sugar just in the condiment that you're putting on top of whatever you're eating at one particular meal. So it's very easy for this to creep up. And you have to be, in terms of being mindful, it's really the only way to sort of measure that and to achieve that gold standard, if you like, of not more than 6 to 9 teaspoons a day is to be really mindful about it and educate yourself about what foods contain sugar and how much and how easy it is to very rapidly accumulate sugar. Now, a lot of these messages, there's been a lot of, you know, pushback, obviously, from food industries and you know, the classic ones are the soft drink industries, because what they've tried to do is, and again, part of the energy in, energy out is, well, this can be part of a healthy diet as long as you exercise with it, you know, the Coke ads of the kids on the beach and running up and down the sand dunes. Oh, well, you can, you know, down as much Coke as you want as long as you go and burn it off, right? But the problem is that, you know, that's not someone's meal. That's just an additive and an addition. And that there's so many sugars hidden in what people perceive to be healthy foods. And that's the big take-home message of that sugar film is just be aware of those hidden sugars in things that where you don't think about. And what one of the big pushes is advocating actually that on packaging, actually have a little teaspoon, food measured that on the nutrition labels, it should say it in teaspoons because people can relate to that. Because people, grams, what's grams? How many grams again? 4 grams, 5 grams? Is that 1 teaspoon? Is that 1 tablespoon? How many spoons? How many and how much per serve? If I eat 100 grams of this, how much? So just actually having a descriptor on it, this, you know, if you pour out that much tomato sauce, that's 3 teaspoons of sugar. And so there's some work being done around that about so that people can actually understand what that means and what that looks like. But there's no doubt that reducing the amount of sugar in your diet is going to be good for you. There's absolutely no positive health benefit other than to the food manufacturers and the doctors, actually, of eating more sugar than that. Fish. So there's been a lot of research done about fish, increasing the amount of fish in the diet, and that has improved outcomes. And then we talk about the balance between the omega-3s and omega-6s, which are some of the fatty acids found in foods. Now, again, it starts to get a little bit technical, but it's got a lot to do with the balance of the omega-3. People hear about omega-3s as being, you know, anti-inflammatory, and a lot of people have probably gone on with, you know, to their doctor or someone else with achy joints or to the pharmacy, oh, here, take some omega-3s, going to be good for your brain, good for your heart. They're really good stuff. Omega-3s are good. But what does all that mean? How much do you need? And really, again, it's about the balance. Now, one of the big things is that, as I keep saying this idea before, is food as medicine. It's always better to get things in the real state. Now, of course, we do use supplements sometimes judiciously, but we should be able to get the nutrients that we need in the foods that we eat and not have to rely, you know, that's a huge. Did anyone see, and I think in The Sun on Sunday, there was a reporter who, you know, confessed that how many thousands of dollars she'd spent in the last year on health. And it was, you know, about $2,000 just on supplements. And then she, you know, agreed at the end that she really didn't need to spend all that money. But it's very easy, the marketing and the push. But obviously everybody's a little bit different. And there are very some specific. So, for example, there's also been some research done with people who have had heart disease of, again, having high dose omega-3s. So there are some very specific uses, but in general, the balance, you need to have about a 3-to-1 ratio of omega-3s to omega-6s, and that's why certain foods are better than others, in particular vegetable oils, the ones that we all, again, found in processed foods. A lot of these things interrelate. So we talk about processed foods. The reason that processed foods in general are bad is because they contain too much sugar, too much of the wrong, unhealthy, toxic oils, probably too much, you know, starches and gluten, and you just don't know what you're eating, and it's too easy to eat too much of them. Just as a general rule, general principle, anything that comes in a box and it can sit on your shelf or the supermarket shelf for 5 years, probably not a great idea to eat it. Anything that comes in the nice packaging that you find, it's found in nature, that's probably what you should be sticking to, just as a general rule. So natural food, so that's what that means. Eat real foods. There's a whole movement, you know, about eating real food. So eating food as it is found in nature. That's the way God intended us to eat. The foods that are provided for us, and I'm sure Menachem can speak a lot about that, about elevating the foods that we have in the world, as opposed to, you know, highly manufactured, highly processed foods. Some people would be pleased to know that there is some correlation between having a little bit of alcohol is actually good for you. Now, you know, the red wine thing years ago, people talk, and that has got to do with the antioxidants found in it, and that's what it says there. What's an antioxidant? What's an oxidant and what's an antioxidant? So every day, every second, not every day, every second, we've all got billions and billions of cells whizzing around our bodies that are changing and transforming and being created and being destroyed. And part of the healthy cell turnover, there's a process called, you know, oxidation of some cells. So when things go wrong under the influence of a lot of this stuff that we'll be talking about the negative stuff, is that then there can be cellular damage that then will go on to cause inflammation, or inflammation causes the cellular damage, which can then go on to the end result being disease or the lack of good health. So antioxidants are foods or substances that can perhaps reverse that process. And so that's why they gain so much traction. I mean, oh, what are we going to eat that's antioxidant? So red wine, dark chocolate, a lot of the, you know, every day we read about a new super health food, the superfoods, blueberries, broccoli, salmon, there's a whole list, kale, quinoa. The latest one is teff. Anyone heard of teff? No. Teff is a grain, again, see, this is all linked in tonight, grown largely in Ethiopia, I think, in Africa. And now it's being recognised. It's a very high protein, easily digested grain that in certain African cultures they use to make flatbreads and things like a porridge. So that's a new look out for it. You'll be hearing more about teff, T-E-F-F, and that's supposed to be the new superfood. So, yeah, can they undo damage? Let's try and just prevent the damage. For example, smoking is something that causes oxidative stress, and that's well documented. That's part of the problem with what smoking does to you, that it causes a lot of oxidative stress. And so that obviously can't, unfortunately, be undone just by eating superfoods. So there's some of the things you can do to protect yourself, eating things at the top. And down the bottom, what are some of the problems, in just specifically in terms of foods? As I mentioned before, eating processed foods, too much alcohol, trans fats. So luckily, trans fats are banned, I think, now in eating establishments and restaurants, because they're cheap, you know, they don't break down, and they're used a lot in food manufacturing, but they're now, so they're definitely linked with causing, again, you know, oxidative damage and other damage in our body. So they're largely banned. But again, in processed foods, you're still going to find, you know, the unhealthy fats used way too much. High GI, so high glycemic index foods. Now, we spoke about limiting your sugar to 6 to 9 teaspoons of sugar a day in all the food that you're eating. So that's why sugars, eating too much sugar, but in particular high GI foods. And that's you only can know that really, and again, this is coming from epidemiological studies, you know, people think that means sweeter foods. It's not necessarily sweeter foods. Now people actually don't talk just about, we talk about glycemic load. So it's all got to do with sort of the natural amount of sugar in foods and the amount of fibre in it, how easily it's broken down and digested. So foods, in other words, that give you a sugar hit quite quickly, they're the ones that we try and stick away from. So, you know, I'm sure a lot of you know about GI, the glycemic index of food. So something that's a score of 100 is high GI, so that's glucose. So if you take some sugar or, you know, glucose, or typically a jelly bean or something, you put it in, you know, it rapidly gets into your bloodstream. It doesn't need to be broken down too much. There's no fibre in them, as opposed to things that have got a lot of, you know, fibre and other nutrients that your body actually needs to break them down to extract the energy or the sugar from them. So eating too many of those, and again, it comes back. I mean, it's all pretty going around in circles, pretty much the same thing. So the highly processed foods. are a problem. So sometimes, you know, I use this acronym, keep it simple. And to me, it really is simple, as it sort of started off. Eat less sugar, eat less processed foods, eat the healthy fats. So we talk about the group of healthy fats, olive oils, coconut, butter, some of the nut oils, so macadamia. Yeah, they're the ones that really you should be making up most of the sort of fats in our diet. So, again, it's not about reducing fat, you know, obsessively, but really transferring to over to healthy fats and eating more, as I said, real food. So, again, you think about it, anything that's found in nature, the way I talk about it, anything that grows on the tree, in the ground, has a face, flies or swims, they're the foods that you should be eating. Simple, isn't it? okay. But now on to the second. We'll have to sort of start writing through. Anyway, activity. So on that side, they're the sort of good different types of activity. And again, we can go into the research. You know, how much aerobic versus resistance versus, you know, strength. The most important thing is to move. Is to get up and move, because we know on this column, sitting too much, being sedentary, not moving enough. Being obese is an independent risk factor and often is associated with not moving enough, but it's more complicated than that. But similarly, excessive exercise. And excessive exercise, I mean, you know, people who exercise for, you know, hours on end a day in this mad attempt to, as we say, you can't outrun a bad diet, but some people are madly, obsessively trying to outrun their bad diet. And so they'll eat whatever they want and then go and spend literally hours in the gym. That can actually cause some, again, sort of stress on the body, apart from just the wear and tear on your joints and stuff. It's been linked with negative health outcomes. So being smart about it. So we're up to, so we started off, yeah, now we're up to the S, yes, nasty. So the third is stress. So obviously, you know, stress is a really important part of, or the lack thereof, or the keeping it under wraps is really important in contributing to health. You know, people always say, why is there so many people, again, there's an epidemic of anxiety. Who heard of anxiety years ago? I mean, I guess people were stressed, but, you know, every second person wasn't anxious. And there are real reasons for that. And I'm a very big believer in our, you know, 24/7 world, information overload. And, you know, I'm young enough, old enough, not quite sure which one to remember the days when the shops closed at 6 o'clock, you went home, it was quiet on the streets, there was no such thing as online shopping. Definitely something to be said for having your day, your activity, and then shutting down, calming down, reading a book, watching TV, going out with your friends, whatever it is. But you couldn't be engaged in shopping or business. There were no emails. Whereas today, as we all know, everything is out there constantly. You know, people say, are there more natural disasters? Are there more, you know, is there more illness in the world? Now, the answer to that is yes, there is a bit more chronic illness, but because we're online all the time, this online, so we know everything that's going on in every corner of the earth. Instantly. So if you think about that, the input to that is that we are constantly on high alert, all of us, because we're always, you know, what's going to be the next news story? So apart from the effect that it has on adults, obviously, is to be very mindful of the effect that it's having on the younger generation, because they know nothing else. That is the only world that they know, where everything is out there available to them, the good, the bad, the ugly, on this constant level. So I have no doubt, and, you know, a lot of psychologists agree that, because basically what we're doing, if you think about it, the old flight versus fright, is that if you've got a, you know, 10-foot or whatever, but the no 10-foot bears, whatever it is, 6-7-foot bear standing in front of me, you need to either say, I need to get out of here as fast as possible, which means my heart will start to race, my blood pressure will go up, my pupils will dilate, get me out of here as quick as possible. Now, we have that figurative bear with us all the time. So, therefore, our adrenaline, our, you know, all these sorts of hormones. So, it's no wonder that people are, you know, highly anxious. And as Menachem said, just practicing a bit of mindfulness every day can be the beginning of a sort of a counter to that, but just to be aware of it. So, there's no doubt that this contributes to anxiety and poor mental health. So, what can we do to relieve it? The perception of having control. Now, almost the definition of anxiety is this feeling of being out of control. So we can feel like we're in control, but we never really are. But maybe that means putting controls on, you know, the amount of technology in your life. Being resilient, whatever that means, being part of a community, getting exercise, as it says there, having a healthy diet, clear relationships, There are very clear relationship between a good diet and mental health, and all the stuff about, again, eating too much sugar, again, my role speaking to school kids. No wonder kids are sort of by 9 o'clock in the morning, 9:30, they come in, they're all sort of, you know, ready to go. By 9:30, go and speak to a lot of teachers. How many of them will complain that by 10 o'clock the kids are, you know, wandering around, getting bored? Well, no wonder, because they've had this highly processed sugar stuff in for breakfast and they're blood sugar levels have gone up and they're ready to go. But by about 10 o'clock, 10:30, they're having a slump. And, you know, poor concentration, irritability, behavioural issues, learning problems. There's no doubt in my mind that's got a lot to do with diet. Now, then, you know, the next thing we talk about is technopathology. Again, like everything in the world, we can use it for the good or we can use it for the bad. Unfortunately, as I said, we're all exposed to this all the time. That doesn't mean it's inherently bad. It's how we choose to use it. But the reality is that people are exposed to this a lot of the time. And apart from, you know, even says exposure to weapons, exposure to natural disasters, exposure to war, all that sort of stuff. So what can we do? How can we control it? Be selective, use it, you know, for the good. And just be very mindful and doing some preventive care, being aware that of the effects that some of these things can have on you and knowing when to have a break from it. We're all very, those of us who, you know, keep 25 hours of Shabbat, it's amazing to be cut off from the world for 25 hours, and that's really what it's all about. I know, you know, people might see it as, how do you do that? And obviously, there's no question that is, especially in this day and age, one of the beauties of keeping Shabbat. Sleep, Menachem mentioned before, sleep is really, really important and it's really easy. Again, and as I keep saying, these things are so interrelated. We're online, we're doing our online shopping, I'm guilty, hands up, I don't have time to go during the week. So, 11 o'clock at night, you can shop for whatever you want. But clearly there's a lot of research being exposed to too much bright light, too much noise, too much stimulation affects the quality of our sleep. You know, limiting that. Now, as it says at the top there, that it's well known, well documented, that sleep deprivation is one of the worst forms of torture and that it actually can induce psychosis. And it's short as about, you know, 48 to 72 hours of people having no sleep, they can become quite psychotic and unwell. So there's a clear relationship. It's not just some people think, you know, it's a sign of being weak that you need to sleep. No. That's actually how we're supposed to be. Our brains tell us at this time of the night we are in some artificial light. But basically, the amount of melatonin in our brain should be going up, preparing us. Our cortisol levels should be going down. Melatonin should be going up, preparing us to sort of shut down at some point. But if we have this constant artificial light stimulation, screens, all of that, we're somehow messing with what should be going on. Now, similarly, having too many stimulants, caffeine, sugar, see, look, there it is again, can affect it. So, you know, put down the bottom there, little guidebook, what can you do, how can you get better sleep? We all talk about good sleep hygiene, having appropriate exercise, eating well, not eating too close to the time of bed, using some mindfulness, relaxation techniques, and again, sort of really important limiting screen time. Now, interestingly, in the list, again, obesity finds its way in, and I just sort of questioned, we know that sleep apnea, for example, is quite common and very much linked to chronic disease, and not just simply to people who are overweight and obese, but there's the whole what we call the metabolic syndrome. And again, this is a whole industry. You know, the other amazing thing is this created a whole new industries, people who deal with sleep apnea when we could really find the answers in all this, the lifestyle stuff that we're talking about. So E is for environment. So I spoke before, you know, does that mean whether you're in a polluted environment? Does it mean where you live? Does it mean, you know, that in our environment where there's too much antibiotics? Everyone talks about the use of antibiotics in agriculture, which means now, you know, a lot of the foods that we eat are a bit tainted, as well as the overuse of antibiotics in medicine as well. Being very mindful of the environment. Some of it we can control, some of it we can't. Some of it might mean making a better choice. Some of it you might realise that living in a different area or a different suburb or more connected to your family or your community can actually be really good for your health. So I know people sort of choose to live, you know, close to where their kids go to school or for some reasons, but living part of a community is really important. So environment, there's a whole lot of different factors that come into environment, not just your postcode. Meaninglessness. So meaning, you know, not having a sense of purpose. As Menachem mentioned before, why do you get up in the morning? So not having that sort of sense of purpose is a direct correlator with poor health. So not being employed, lack of purpose, not having fulfillment, feeling displaced. And what can you do to help is finding purpose, finding meaning. That might be coming to a place like this, having good relationships, healthy relationships, and really trying to find that balance in your life about you're not just getting up to go to work and come home and take the dog for a walk and sit down and eat dinner, but really what else is there to what is it really all about? So some of these things, you know, really negative, aren't they? But alienation, so being isolated, not having good support systems. Again, you see how there's very common threads here. So having good relationships, being part of a community are really, really important. Also support and education. So the counter to it is having acceptance and support. So the band-aid there down the bottom. Having a sense of belonging, having some pride in who you are, what you are, belonging to a community, belonging to a group. Are all really important determinants. So we're going through the list. We're up to O for occupation. Now, it's more about what it can be some of the negative things. Obviously, people who work shift work, because then they might be getting broken sleep. Again, sometimes you can't control that. Being exposed to things, maybe being exposed, the obvious ones is, you know, dangerous chemicals, things like asbestos, but other sort of occupational health and safety issues, being involved to stress at work. Now, sometimes, again, we can't get out of that, but just being aware, conflict in the workplace is obviously can have very negative impacts on people's health. So sometimes we can't change any of this, but just to be aware of the impact of them and make the changes where we can. Clearly, we all know about the effects of drugs, smoking and alcohol. As I mentioned before, smoking causes oxidative stress. But the question that I pose there is, why do people engage in some of these behaviours, which everyone knows are bad? So is it because they're suffering from some of the things on the previous slides? They're alienated, they don't feel that they belong, there's a lack of acceptance, they're trying to find meaning, and therefore people, you know, go for things that might make them feel good, satisfy their nefesh bahamit very quickly, but really no good can come of it. Or is it that because they're addicted or rely on these things too much that those other things come in the as a result? So is it cause or effect? So the things that can counter, obviously, again, it's very similar. Having social support, having good networks, resilience. So very common themes about what can contribute to some of these things. What do we mean by exposure? So there's been a lot of work done about, and again, this comes back to the environment, where you live, how much sunlight you're exposed to. Now, we know having too much sun is no good. As I mentioned before, if I go out in the sun, I'm actually allergic to the sun. Like, it's not just sunburn. And as the dermatologist said to me, if I was allergic, you were allergic to penicillin, you wouldn't take penicillin, would you? So everyone's different, but we know overexposure to sun is no good. It causes, again, oxidative stress, oxidative damage. It causes damage, you know, Australia is the world's capital of skin cancer, which is the cancer is the end result of inflammation and damage to cells. When the cells can't correct themselves and can't repair themselves, cancer is the end result of that. Where you live, the climate that you live in, for example, something, you know, we have relatively low vitamin D. We just spoke about not having too much sun, but not having enough sun is also can be a negative determinant for health. So there's an association with, for example, living in certain areas, and we have high rates of, for example, multiple sclerosis, and even diabetes is linked to low vitamin D levels. And we certainly know there's different patterns of disease and patterns of illness depending on where you live. So sometimes you can fix that, sometimes you can't. SAD. So SAD stands for seasonal affective disorder, that probably some of you have heard of. And this, again, relates to the low levels of sunlight, low levels of natural light in the winter. Some people clearly get depressed in the winter months, and it's not just because it's a bit grey. Well, it is because it's a bit grey outside, but it's been found to be very linked to the amount of sunlight and sun exposure. And so, for example, in certain, you know, Scandinavian and other countries where they go for months of the year with very little natural light, they actually have light boxes that some people respond to really well. So people where there's a clear deterioration in their mental health and in their moods in the winter months, they use sort of some sort of artificial light. Yep.
How can we determine how much light we need, how much sunlight we need?
Okay.
It's either too much, then we get burnt, or not enough, we don't get enough vitamin D. So how do we...
That is a very good question, and again, that depends where you live. But in Australia, I mean, we talk about about 15 minutes of exposure in the middle of the day, in sort of not the peak summer months, but let's say from, October, November, maybe beginning of December, in the middle of the summer, probably less, 10 minutes a day, depends on the UV. In the winter months it's really hard to get enough sunlight because there isn't enough. And that's why I tell people take some vitamin D supplement in the winter months because it's very hard. And also depends on what you do, whether you're inside, outside, And so, for example, walking early in the morning or late at night, you might be outside a lot, but you're not going to get a lot of vitamin D. You're not going to get a lot of... Not really. I mean, again, depends where... That's all we use, an average of about 15 minutes a day, in between 10 and 3. Yep.
I talked to you this morning by Professor Rolla, who was talking about that most doctors are saying that people don't have enough vitamin D and they suffer with osteoporosis, for example. And the main thing is most doctors are now saying take vitamin D tablets regardless because of this lack of... now the weather's very temperamental.
Yep. Yeah, so vitamin D was a bit of a fatty thing that a few years ago, because we're the sunburnt country, right? Australia's a sunburnt country, so it is actually there is a lot of history to this. So in the 20s and the 30s, in Europe and America, they recognised, people have heard of rickets, that children develop rickets, soft bones, they get those bowed legs and broken bones and this sickly children, and they recognised that the link between vitamin D and sunlight and vitamin D and the development of bone issues and other illness. And so I'm not so much sure in Europe and the UK, but in America, milk is fortified with vitamin D. But always Australia, we don't need to do that in Australia because we're the sunburned country, there's so much sun here. So then, maybe about 15 years, people were saying, well, hang on a second, that might be true, but then we had the slip, slop, slap. So no one goes outside anymore because we're told that that's not good either. And then a lot of people work inside. So yes, we might be the sunburned country, which isn't great to do that. Maybe there's not enough. So we started religiously measuring everyone's vitamin D's, and no one quite knew what the reference range. But anyway, all of a sudden, everybody's vitamin D deficient because we probably set the bar a bit low.
And now the doctors don't want to say...
So then the government said, hey guys, just stop all this. This is ridiculous. Everyone's getting their vitamin D checked every 5 minutes, costing the government a lot of money. And if you're low, take a supplement. If you're not, don't. Simple. And so what I tell a lot of people is exactly in the winter months, so probably from about March onwards, March, April, take it through to about November and stop. Don't worry about it. Now, there are certain risk groups. So women who are covered head to toe, very dark-skinned people, they need more sunlight than us. So there are people who are at higher risk where we probably do need to measure it. And I always sort of tell this story because I guess it was like my sort of first exposure to low vitamin D and I work not far from here in East St Kilda, and years ago this lovely Greek family whose children went to Wesley were my patients, and there were some older sort of school-age kids, and then there was a baby. And the baby was about one and started to have epileptic seizures, and he's very, anxious, worried parents, as you would be, take the baby off to the hospital and they'd do all sorts of tests and look, we're really sorry, we think your baby's got epilepsy, and give the baby all these anti-epileptic drugs, and a few weeks would go by, it'd be all right, and then the baby would have more seizures and they'd go back to the hospital. Oh, this drug's not working, have another drug. And it wasn't until about the third or the fourth hospital admission that a young doctor said, has anyone checked the baby's calcium and vitamin D? And the baby had unrecordable vitamin D, which was actually interfering with calcium, which was actually triggering the seizures. And when they went and asked questions, and that's why I suppose it puts all of this into context, you can't take things in isolation. That's part of a doctor, is how to take a good hit. You've got to, we're detectives. Basically what was happening, this one-year-old was being ferried in the car all day back and forth. And that's why it's relevant to say where I work, where the kids went to school, because the mum was ferrying. This baby was never outside. And a bit dark-skinned, Greek background. And once the baby had the correct supplementation, no more seizures. It's really good. So that was years ago. I'm thinking, oh, my God, everywhere, I'm not checking vitamin D's enough. But that was sort of a bit extreme. But it did highlight that, again, that's an environmental, where you live, they're Greek origin, dark skin. They need to be outside more. And this poor baby, just because it had a 9 and a 10-year-old sibling, was never outside. Anyway, so it's just a good story to highlight a lot of the stuff we've been talking about today. So radiation, obviously being exposed to too much radiation, asbestos we all know historically, and it's still around in a lot of old buildings, isn't good. So exposure to too many things. Now, as we said, keep talking about relationships are really important and a really important factor. But again, you know, if you've got supportive relationships, you're possibly more inclined to go for a walk because you've got someone to walk with. So none of these things are standalone. As it, you know, it says there, we know that loneliness is going to have a negative impact on you, and it can make it hard to find meaning in your life. But we do know on the positive side that all those sorts of things can be positive. And the last one, the S, is about social inequality. And we know that clearly there's, as I mentioned before, depends which suburb you live in, depends what educational opportunities you've got, depends what they is on special in the supermarket in your suburb. It depends, you know, in the suburbs around here, there's very large, quite well-stocked healthy fruit and veggie items aisles, because that's what people in these suburbs want and look for, and they like the organic department. But probably if you go out to some of the western other suburbs, going to be, you know, it's not going to be a great variety, and people aren't exposed to it and don't have the same opportunities. So there's all sorts of determinants.
Disagree with that. Our daughter lives in Brunswick, and she's quite in the lecture as well.
Yeah,
she's a lawyer. No,
absolutely. I mean, there's no it's sort of not a hard and fast, but if you'll do a little bit of research into different, within the same supermarket chain, how many fresh fruit items there'll be in certain suburbs as opposed to others, and that's what I mean. So talking more, you know, about supermarkets in particular. No, I'm sure not. All right, so. Seize on me now.
Excuse me, Doctor.
Yes.
What do you mean by trust can lead to negative health outcomes?
That's a good question. Inequality in any of key markers. Yeah, so if there's an inequality in it. So if any inequalities in any of those things, where you don't have the same sort of financial, the same wealth or the same support, or you can't trust those who you're providers, it's going to possibly have some negative outcomes. All right, so in summary, as we started off, we talked about staying in good shape and avoiding the nasty malodors that we just went through in a little bit of depth and detail. Basically, though, I like to go home with the simple, keep it simple, it's nutrition, it's exercise, exercise activity, I think, is a more important way of putting it. And as Menachem mentioned, sleep. So the other, you know, top one, smoking avoidance, that's very clear cut, and that's, you know, well documented over many years. So those three, eating, activity, and not smoking, are what considered sort of the penicillin. As I said before, back in the day, you got rid of the nasty infectious diseases through all the public health and drugs, and you got better health outcomes. Now we need to look much broader. There are many, it's multifactorial. And as we've been saying all night, that they're all very interrelated. Used to be it was quite simple, it was linear, now it's a lot more. So now we talk about having, you know, systems models, and that we really need to, you know, factor in. And as the bottom line says, it's really a lot, there's a lot more to it than just simply what we put in our mouths. I think that's the end.
Take a couple of questions.
Yeah.
So before we wind up, I'd like to thank my mother-in-law, Dr. Herbst, for presenting tonight. Always one of the more holistic approach lectures that we have, and we're very fortunate to have many good speakers. There was one very interesting minor point on technology, which Dr. Craig Hassett referenced when he lectured here last month, and he said, you know, it'll be interesting in 20, 25 years from now, we'll have it all sorted out. We'll know how to use technology. And until then, we're just going to be the trial test tube generation that that our children are going to learn from. But it's not hard. It's not hard. I don't know if there were like 15 things that we had to remember, but if you actually just come back to living a logical lifestyle of, yes, go out for a walk with your partner, you'll probably tick off three things on that list. Try to eat less processed food and more whole food, you'll probably tick off another three things on that list. So it's not about remembering all the details as much as remembering to do the general things that include many of those details. But tonight's lecture has been recorded and will be uploaded with the slides so that you can revise and you can remember all the specifics that were mentioned tonight. We'll take two questions, of course, three questions, and then, of course, it's not even about asking. I don't think you'll let my mother-in-law out of the building if she doesn't answer questions, so I'm sure she'll be open to take a few more after. So we'll do number one, number two, I've got to jump to this side, and number three in the back. And then everyone else, you're more than welcome, just attack the lectern as soon as we finish tonight. So number one.
Hi. Thanks very much for your lecture. I feel like a lot of what we've been speaking about tonight is our messages that we have been hearing a lot for the past 5 years, but or even 10 years or longer, but we still aren't doing it. Like getting enough sleep, going for walks, eating healthy. We've been told this a lot of times, but we're still not doing it. So I'm wondering if you can suggest, like, even any way for us to be able to actually start doing it. Or is mindfulness being... like, say, taking 15 minutes of meditation being suggested as the link between taking what we know we should be doing and actually being able to make a difference in our lives because of using that sort of, like, mind over emotional kind of thing that you were talking about before, Malcolm. Is that the take-home message?
Yeah, I think it's a bit of all of the above. But interestingly also what you're saying is I think one of the reasons that it is so hard, and you're right, these messages, you know, these aren't new, these are things that people have been talking about already for a number of years, is that in the wider community, though, you're still being bombarded with the opposite. So we all talk about, you know, when you go to the supermarket, just stay on the perimeter of the supermarket and try not to get, because the more you get into the middle, the more highly processed the foods are. But the reality is that there's, I can't remember how many thousand, hundred, you know, tens of thousands of products in every supermarket, and that is where most people shop. And that is, so you know, almost daily you're being, intellectually, you know, well, I should be sticking to these and these foods, but the variety and the abundance and the availability of all those things, plus the lifestyles of most people around you who, you know, again, obviously we all have individual choice and we all need to make those healthy choices. So I'd like to think it would be, you know, again, as I started off, as simple as saying, well, we've all got a purpose. You know, like I used to tell my kids every day when they went on the way to school, be the best that you can be. So sort of decide that that's what you're starting out with. I want to be the best that I can be. And I know through my education and what I've heard and wanting to have sort of the most sort of healthy, productive life is that I need to take these on board. Now, we're all, it's all a process. If we think about what Menachem spoke about, you know, in Hasidic thought, this mind over matter thing, it's all a process. We all battle this every day. We don't always win, but it's about as much about the battle, and you know, maybe battle is a bit of a harsh word, but about achieving as much as you can. I don't know if that really answers, but that's what it is. It's a process. It's really a process. And again, when I speak to the kids, they say that to me. They say, so we need to go and lobby the supermarket. They shouldn't sell. You know, I remember one kid got up and said, so why are they allowed to sell Coke in the supermarket? Literally, you know, these passionate, you know, 15-year-olds. That's their answer. Their answer is they should not be allowed. It should be banned. It should have the warnings on it, like cigarettes, and which is, by the way, a realistic thing that some people are thinking of. But so for the kids, it's also black and white. Just don't do it. Just don't sell it in the supermarkets. But the reality is it's still there. So it's, our micro environment and our macro environment. And that's what I, again, love about the kids, because I think they will affect change. They'll lobby, you know, I say, you know, get some lobby groups out. Go home, speak to your friends, speak to your parents, speak to your whatever. So that macro environment still hasn't changed. So we've got a long way to go. And then there's a whole other thing, obviously, about the food and drug industries, really. We won't get into the conspiracy theories, but they really have a lot to answer for. Yep.
Number two.
Thank you.
Yep.
What's your view now of the current problem where, you know, there's more encouragement about eating fish, but now they say that salmon is farmed and they fed terrible things, that it's an adverse thing to eat, and other fish that are farmed like that. So how do you choose, and what do you do about that?
That's also an excellent question. You know, this whole idea about, you know, organic. You go in your supermarket and there'll be one little section where there's the organic carrots and the organic things, and then so you read all the organic stuff is better than the other stuff. So again, it's about being informed and being educated. And you're quite right. In an ideal world, we'd only have grass-fed beef and grass, you know, and free-range chickens who aren't fed on grains, who are left to roam and eat the natural seeds and grasses that they're that they find in their environment. Cows should be able to roam and eat grass, shouldn't be fattened, shouldn't be given antibiotics. And again, it's all a matter of aiming for the best that is available to you in terms of availability, in terms of economic factors and considerations, in terms of feeding a family sometimes. So it's about, you know, doing the best that you can. So in general, again, less processed foods, more real foods. Look, you know, again, some people will say exactly if it's farmed, well, it's not good. It's still better than eating McDonald's. I think you've got to sort of keep it in some sort of context, in some sort of perspective. That yes, maybe there's some, you know, there is some subtle advantage to having, you know, wild salmon as opposed to farmed salmon, but in the bigger picture, eating salmon's good.
If I could just add, yes. From. Every year we have Irina Gollum, who's a well-known nutritionist here in Melbourne, come and speak. And she always talks about chocolate cake and the evils and the perils of eating chocolate cake. But she says it's very important that when you eat chocolate cake, to have no guilt. Because the guilt that goes with chocolate cake does a lot more damage to your stomach than the eating of the chocolate cake. So if I could just build on that same thing, not everyone can afford to have the optimal diet, but the guilt that goes with "I can't" can also do a lot of damage in its own right. Number three.
Just if on like coconut oils, coconut butters, coconut milk, coconut cream, coconut yep. water, like where does everything lie in terms of monounsaturated fat, saturated fat? Like what's going on?
Okay, so again, back to the old, you know, the low fat era that we've been living with, you know, sort of for the last 40 years, where fat's the devil, fat's evil, fat's the cause of all the ills in the world. And so, yeah, coconut was definitely demonised because it's, in terms of, you know, fruit and vegetable, the only one that's saturated fat. So saturated fat was thought to be the devil. We won't go into all the history why that is. You know, back in the late 50s, 60s, it was the battle was on. What's the cause of heart disease? Is it sugar or fat? And sugar won. So fat's the devil, sugar's the victor. And there's definitely a lot of politics involved in that. And so for 40 years, we've been suffering ever since. So in particular, coconut oil is saturated fat. And it was very easy, and a big part of the problem is that the word for being overweight is fat, and the word for dietary lipids is also fat. So it's a very negative connotation, and it's very easy to convince people that fat, these clog your arteries, look at that thick, gooey, white stuff. That can't be good for you. So there's a lot of emotion around that. So saturated fats, and people believe this, I believed it, that saturated fats are what's clogging our arteries. We now know, and I did touch on oxidative stress and inflammation, inflammatory damage, the reason that people's arteries got clogged is not because of the fats that they're eating. It's, well, it could be if they're eating the unhealthy, toxic vegetable seed-based fats. It's because of the inflammatory damage in the arteries. And the body's response to that inflammation is actually to line it with some nice, healthy cholesterol. We haven't touched on cholesterol tonight. So this whole thing about coconut oil. So there are a lot of health benefits to coconut oil and all the coconut products that you mentioned. Again, we have to be a little bit careful not to jump on the bandwagon too far and, you know, just eat coconut and you'll be healthy, you know, because we know, you know, any sort of radical, it's all about balance. That's one of the take-home messages for tonight, is it is about balance. But coconuts are certainly healthy.
How do you check then? How do you check, like, coconut's a good saturated fat? And
the first thing to say is saturated fat is not inherently bad. Saturated fat does not, a lot of the studies that all this stuff was based on, that, you know, we've got to cut the fat off the meat and take the chicken off the skin and saturated fat is bad, have all been largely refuted, and people have gone back and looked at the studies going, So we all thought, because it looks like fat, it's thick and gooey, it must clog up your arteries.
But DAA still says, I just read it, but I'm just saying.
They do. They've got a lot.
I prefer your answer, but keep going.
They've got a lot. I have to be careful. They've got a lot to answer for. What can I say?
No. Because I agree. All saturated fats are unequal because it's been proven, but, I mean...
Saturated fats are not inherently bad.
Which ones? Like, how do we know?
Any saturated fat. So, the fat... So,
Peanut oil
is a different category. I'll talk about it in a minute. But so when we think about saturated, mainly, apart from coconut, saturated fats is only an animal product. Coconut is the only non-animal form of saturated fat.
Yeah.
Yes.
So should we buy low-fat milk or normal milk?
Normal full cream milk.
Full cream milk.
I need to come back again, I see. Cheese is good.
Unless you're trying to lose weight, then
you got... Oh, no. See, how long have we got, Menachem?
So I'm going to invite everyone to come up. I think as a follow-up from tonight, and we're about to conclude putting together our next term of programs, and perhaps there's a night on cholesterol and fat that needs to be had with you. We're not going to bother getting someone else if we've got someone who already has baited the crowd to learn more, because I think it is very, very important, because it's probably the most common question that we have at the lectures around food, which is, okay, so fat, good or bad, cholesterol, good or bad, my doctor says this, my doctor's of this original thinking, and then every so often you get some, my doctor says that, and we've got some new thinking. So I think we'll continue that further at a lecture, although we can continue after. But I want to wrap up tonight with, there's an online group which I'm a part of, and often there are people... They come from more philosophical spaces of the world philosophies to explain why things are the way they are. And there's a point that someone made recently about religion, and that is that religion, like it or not, and they were talking about the Eastern traditions, and Judaism actually got a mention in this, that the older traditions of the world, even though they didn't have science within their community, so to speak, they seem to bring a lot of wisdom together. And if you follow a discipline in your life, you're probably better off than if you're trying to wing it and work it out yourself. And so maybe to come back to the first question that we had this evening is that perhaps we need to adopt a discipline with our meaning. And if we adopt that discipline in our life, we say, well, we're going to do this. We know all the information. We've just got to make that decision that I want to fit into a framework for my life. Then we might be able to start adopting a lot of what we've learnt tonight. I'd like to thank you all for coming this evening. It's been fantastic, and the enthusiasm is brilliant, because it means 50, 60 odd people go home tonight and will start making a difference in their households and within their sub-communities that exist here in Melbourne. And I'm looking forward to seeing everyone back either next week or the week after or next term. Wishing you a very good night.